I am Dr. Harish Babu Reddy, consultant gastroenterologist at Manipal Hospitals, Malleshwaram and Jayanagar, Bangalore. Today, in this Facebook Live program, I will be talking about fatty liver in the next 15 to 20 minutes. I decided this topic of fatty liver as we are very commonly seeing in the OPD day-to-day practice. One of the main patients come to us with the reports of fatty liver. So we'll be understanding about this fatty liver in the next 15 to 20 minutes under 4 or 5 subheadings. Like as to know like what is a fatty liver, what are the causes of fatty liver, who are the population at risk for developing this fatty liver, and how this fatty liver progresses over a period of time to become what we call as cirrhosis, and what how does they present to us, like what are the problems which patients face from day to day with this fatty liver problems, and what are the tests and what are the treatment options which were available. And more importantly, I'll be discussing what are the preventive measures we can take in preventing this fatty liver and also progression of this fatty liver from stage to second stage to third stage to become a cirrhosis. So now coming to the first question, like what is fatty liver? As like it is there in the name, fatty liver means there's excess fat in the liver. It's said that according to our research, it has been said that more than 5% of hepatocytes filled, that hepatocytes are the liver cells filled with fat is called as, we call it as a fatty liver, or even more than 5% of the dry weight of the liver, whenever it is more than 5% fat content, we call it as a fatty liver. Coming to the types of fatty liver, the most commonly we have alcoholic related fatty liver, and the second one broadly we classify as a non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Alcoholic fatty liver is completely altogether a different topic which we will discuss in next sessions, but today our discussion will limit it to the non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, which is very, very common, including even in children of late, we are seeing these patients. Coming to this fatty liver, who are these people who come with fatty liver to us? These are the patients who are usually obese, who have diabetes, who have cholesterol issues, what we call as dyslipidemia, and who are usually have this sedentary lifestyle. These are the patients, or these are the people when they go for a routine ultrasound checkup, or ultrasound is done for some other health issue, then they get this fatty liver report and then they usually come and see a gastroenterologist. So this fatty liver over a period of time, because of this global rise in epidemic of the obesity, that is reflecting in the fatty liver also. It is like, it is a kind of a reflection of the obesity towards diabetes or towards hypertension. It is the same gastro component, what we call as a fatty liver. And over a period of time, especially in the European and American countries, it has become a most common reason for chronic liver disease, what we call as cirrhosis. Even in India also, we can see that there is a lot of increase in these fatty liver cases in the middle-aged group people. And also, we are seeing very commonly even in the children also because of the lifestyle and food habit changes. And over a period of time, it can be a very big epidemic turning into, you know, progression into chronic liver disease. So it's better that we understand it in the very early stages and try to prevent it from the progression or even revert it back to normal with all our lifestyle and food habit changes. So if you see in the general population, it is said that like 25% of the people out of 100, 25 people are known to have fatty liver. And if you see in a patient who are obese and diabetic, it can be as high as 45 to 50% of the people can have this fatty liver in one of these stages, whatever the stages of the fatty liver it is. So now coming to the stages of the fatty liver and how this fatty liver kind of progresses over a period of time. So this fatty liver, whatever we call, the broadly word we use as NAFLD, that is called non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. This non-alcoholic fatty liver disease basically has three stages. One of the first stage is fatty liver, that is just there is a fat deposition in the liver, but there is no any swelling of the liver or there is no any damage to liver cells or what we call as hepatocytes. But over a period of time, because of this excess fat getting into the liver and deposition, the liver will start getting swollen. And along with that, this fat will also keep on damaging the liver cells that we call as hepatocytes damage. So along with this hepatocytes damage and the swollen liver, what we call it as a NASH, that is NASH. So it means that non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. Steatohepatitis means because of the fat, there is a damage to the liver cells leading to the inflammation within the liver. But one thing we should all know is liver is one beautiful organ wherein it has a lot of regeneration ability. So whenever there is a damage by whatever mechanism, it can be because of the fat or it can be because of alcohol or it can be because of the viruses. Still, the liver always tries to kind of come back to its normal, this normal capacity. But when this process becomes repetitive and chronic always, then what happens? There will be repeated damage to the liver again and again. So that leads to scarring. Once the scarring comes into the liver will start becoming stiff, the liver will start shrunken in size, and it might become even a nodules on the surface. That's when we use that word as a cirrhosis. Once it goes to cirrhosis, that is where it is difficult for a liver to come back. But whenever it is in the fatty liver stage or a non-alcoholic steatohepatitis phase, it can usually come back to normal by the changes in the lifestyle and dietary, which I'll be discussing with you in the later discussion. But once it becomes cirrhosis, that is when there is a permanent scarring. That means the liver has become stiff, the liver has become decreased in size, it cannot come back to its normal. So we should all take these preventive steps to prevent progression of fatty liver to the cirrhosis. Once it becomes cirrhosis, it can be cirrhosis, it will behave like the same way as alcoholic patients, or it can be some viral related problem. So once cirrhosis happens, it can progress to become what we call like you can have a decompensation of this by terms of blood omitting or jaundice, or there will be fluid accumulation or what we call ascites in the abdomen. And then further it can even lead to, very rarely, to even hepatocellular carcinoma, the liver cancer also, to sometimes. So this, we have to always target these patients very early, and we need to understand this in the terms of fatty liver and NASH and try to prevent it from further progression to the further disease. So this is how the fatty liver progresses. But it progresses over a long period of time. It takes around like 10 to 15 years if there are no further insults. Like further insult means if this patient starts taking alcohol, then this progression can occur very fast. If this patient gets some viral infection, this progression can happen in 5 to 10 years also. But only fatty liver will take around 15 to 20 years. So as of now, whenever we see a fatty liver patient who has progressed into cirrhosis, they're usually in the older age group, like say 50 or in the 60s. But because this fatty liver is now coming in the very early age group, like the children and in the first to second decade itself, these patients by the age of 40 to 50, when they are really economically and socially they are working, they are really productive in that age group, in that age group they start developing cirrhosis. That's when it's going to have a big impact personally and also an economic impact towards, on a larger scale, towards the country also. So this is how the fatty liver kind of progresses. Now, who are these people whom we should be worried about, and like who are these patients whom we should be very careful to screen and like identify these high-risk patients, what we call, and try to intervene as early as possible. So the first group of people is the obesity. And obesity, as you guys already know, it is rising epidemic in this every part of the world and even in India also. So whenever we have like what we call as a body mass index, for Southeast Asians, it is said that the ratio, if it is more than 23.5, we call it as a obesity in those patients who are at high risk. And the second group of patients are those who already have a type 2 diabetes mellitus. That is the second component. Third patients are those who are already having cholesterol issues in terms of high total cholesterol or high triglyceride levels. These are all the people who can have this high risk for developing the fatty liver. Next, even some viral infections like our hepatitis C, that can also kind of predispose to fat accumulation. And one important thing is all of the people should watch on for what medicines you are taking, and you should always discuss with your doctor or with whomever healthcare practitioner you are seeing what are its effects on the liver. Because liver is kind of, it will face the brunt of all the medicines what we use in a day-to-day practice, either it can be steroids, it can be any other counter, like when we take the over-the-counter medicine or alternative medicines, even to some extent, excess vitamin A, that also can cause like fat accumulation in the liver. So these are some of the risk groups, but there are some even genetic predisposition also. But these are the factors where we can identify this subgroup of people and educate them about this fatty liver and try to prevent it to further progression into the liver disease. Now coming to the clinical manifestations, means how do these patients usually get present to the OPD, or how do they come to know that either they're having a fatty liver or not? Most of the times it is just asymptomatic. They don't have any issues because of the fat accumulation in the liver, because it is such a ability for a liver to kind of carry on its functions with normalcy. So, but once in a while we get to see people like have some mild discomfort below the right rib cage, that is like the liver area. Or usually patients will have either fatigue or some kind of lethargy. they don't know, but they're not able to cope up with the normal work. They get tired easily. This is some of the presentations usually what we see. But once the fatty liver progresses to cirrhosis, that what we call chronic liver disease or cirrhosis of the liver, that will be same manifestations irrespective of whatever is the problem. Either it is because of alcohol or it's because of this non-alcoholic fatty liver disease or the virus infection, doesn't matter. Those patients will develop, have a jaundice, they can have accumulation of, you know, fluid in the abdomen, what we call as ascites. They can have the blood vomiting and they can have decreased concentration, altered sensorium and all these things. So these are the complete clinical manifestations wherein we kind of identify these patients and kind of intervene them very highly. Why I am stressing on this NAFLD too much is, this has a lot of associated problems in the same patient. Like they can have diabetes, they can have cholesterol issues, they can have a heart problem, or they can have a stroke problem, or any of these problems. They all are kind of associated in the same family. So this is the non-alcoholic fatty liver disease or fatty liver what I'm talking today. It is a component of that syndrome that we call as a metabolic syndrome. It is a gastro manifestation of whatever the metabolic syndrome we call. So once we take care of fatty liver, or once we take care of a diabetes or cholesterol levels, it's indirectly we are taking care of the complete body. So it will help us to lead a better quality of life. And at the end of the day, we can try to decrease the doses of medicines required for even associated conditions. So now next, coming to what are the impacts, like how does this fatty liver is going to affect the people or public in a day-to-day practice? Because once the liver becomes cirrhosis, as I told you, that can have its own complications, which I already discussed. But they are also at risk for cardiovascular complications, what we call like a coronary artery disease, or what we call heart attack, or that kind of problems are more in this fatty liver patients. Actually, the fatty liver patients, most of the time, they have a problem more of this coronary disease or heart disease rather than the fatty liver itself. And these are the patients who are also at risk for like some of the malignancies. See, once the liver becomes cirrhosis, that carries itself the risk of carrying the developing the cancer at the rate of 1 to 4% over decade for every patient. But that we have a screening. But also it can have increase in the risk of, you know, large intestine adenomas, what we call polyps, it can be more. And even it can raise the incidence of large intestine cancer also sometimes. And in females, it has been linked with sometimes, they can even also develop the breast carcinoma also in these patients. So we should be very careful with respect to the management of obesity, because that is going to affect the body in from every like organ aspect. And these patients, as I told you, they're increased risk for liver cancer, they're increased risk for coronary artery disease or what we call as heart attacks, and also they can have increased risk for developing the brain stroke also. So after understanding how they present the clinical manifestations and how the disease progresses and at-risk patients also, now let us kind of learn about how to diagnose this fatty liver. How to diagnose and how to assess the severity also, then we'll discuss later after that the management. So coming to the diagnosis, it's always, as I told you, this non-alcoholic fatty liver disease is in those patients who are taking alcohol less than 20 grams per day for less than 5 days a week. If these patients are consuming more alcohol, then there can be both the components. There can be component of the alcohol also, and there can be component of the non-alcohol also. Otherwise, it will be only the non-alcohol component. Along with that, we always, whenever the fatty liver patient comes, we check for their thyroid, their diabetes, their cholesterol issue, and their BP, blood pressure. Depending on the parameters, we might even ask for a ECG and echo also to know the cardiac status. But whenever we get this fatty liver patient, we do the routine blood test, what we call complete hemogram, and more importantly, what we are interested in, the liver function test. If the liver function test, if the SGOT and SGPT, what we call liver enzymes, if that values are absolutely normal, then means the fatty liver is still in the stage 1. It has not started affecting the fatty liver. So that is a very ideal time for people to learn about it and try to prevent it from further progression. But if the liver enzyme starts rising, what we call SGOT and SGPT, if they are more than whatever the cutoff levels or whatever, like less than, more than 39 or more than 40 from the lab values, and in sometimes females we consider lesser value also. If that is there, then it means that the fat has started affecting the liver. So that means it has gone into the second stage, that is non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. Once the patient goes into non-alcoholic steatohepatitis and this liver values have kind of started rising, then we always check in all these patients for a viral marker, that is, we look for hepatitis B and hepatitis C test. And depending upon the age group, like, and also for a female patients, we always try to rule out the autoimmune hepatitis by doing some of the blood tests. And in some patients, we also consider ruling out the Wilson disease also. But in Indian setting, we should be aware that most of our people, either from villages, rural side, or even from the urban also, have an like, they're very much the liver problem itself tell them to take kind of go and take some alternative medicines or over-the-counter medicines. Most of the time, these medicines are always at risk of damaging the liver. We should be very, very careful when we are trying to take any medicine which is outside the prescription of a doctor. And even with your doctor, please always discuss what are its impacts on liver for any other medicine also. So we always rule out viral markers, we rule out autoimmune conditions in females and younger male patients also, and we rule out this Wilson's disease also. And always we ask for your any of the medicine, whatever you are taking, whatever the preparations you are taking, you may think it is not a medicine, but always tell your doctor that I am taking this and this supplement. Because for us it's easier to identify and to further tell you to, you know, kind of either stop it or whether to, is there any treatment we can give it on, it will be easier job. Next, coming to the imaging modalities. Imaging modalities, we tell always about like ultrasound. Ultrasound is the easiest investigation because it's available across the country, even in rural settings, everywhere the ultrasound is present. And it's a very simple investigation and very sensitive. So it will diagnose fatty liver and it will tell us like there are even grades of fatty liver in the ultrasound. The radiologist, whenever they're telling, they will try to, you know, based on their appearance of the liver with respect to spleen and kidney, they grade as grade 1, grade 2 and grade 3 also. Then in some patients, we also consider doing an MR elastography or even CT scan. They are also best modalities. But MR elastography is something which will give us more information about the fat content also and also the liver stiffness. So sometimes when we have very obese patients wherein we can't do this ultrasound, or next what I'll be discussing is the FibroScan investigation. In them, we ask them to go for a MR elastography, wherein it will give us the exact information for us, how much is the fat accumulation in the liver and how much is the stiffness, or how much the liver has become really stiff and how much the liver has shrunken in size. But of late, the very recent advances in the science and technology, we have got a machine called FibroScan. Because of FibroScan, we are able to avoid very, very required cases of liver biopsy. We are not at all doing liver biopsy in any of these patients unless until it's really required. Because this FibroScan, which is a simple machine which is similar to ultrasound and even easier than that to do it off. So we're keeping a probe on the liver by 10 times. That machine will analyze the fat content and it will present as what we call CAP value, that is controlled attenuation parameter. And we also get LSM, that is liver stiffness measurement. Based on these two values, we can tell the patient about what stage of fatty liver they are in, how much the liver has become stiff really, then what are the treatment medicines which are available according to the whatever stage they are in. And these values can be different with respect to the different etiology also. Like for a fatty liver, it is a different cutoff. For a for alcoholics, it's a different. For viral markers, viral diseases, it's a different thing. And for also for cholestatic, what we call deep jaundice patients also, there's different cutoff. But once this liver stiffness measurement, usually that value will be between 2 to 6. But once it starts going 7 and above, then we call as it has gone into the F2 fibrosis, which is really important and we need to pay more attention for it. And liver biopsy, usually we don't do it in a straightforward cases of fatty liver. But whenever there is a diagnostic dilemma or we think that just a fatty liver is not explaining the blood reports and the scan reports, then we might consider doing a liver biopsy. That is a one-day procedure wherein patient gets admitted for a day in a hospital. And with the needle, we just poke into the liver and remove a piece of tissue and send it for the microscope. But routinely, we don't do it now because of the availability of the FibroScan and MR elastography. But whenever there is a dilemma, whenever there is we are not able to explain, especially in young patients, or the values of the liver tests are very, very high, sometimes we do consider doing a liver biopsy. So after understanding how do you diagnose and how we understood all about this clinical manifestation, now the most important part, let us come to how to treat it, and more than important, how to prevent it from the progression to the cirrhotic stage. The first and foremost for all this, what we call as a metabolic syndrome, which includes everything, which includes diabetes, which includes cholesterol issues, the bad cholesterol being high, or it can be even hypertension, and even it can be fatty liver. It is always going to be the dietary and the lifestyle measures. The dietary changes with respect to the fatty liver is basically to target your weight loss at least like say 10% of your normal weight. That should be done gradually over a period of 6 months. So you need to cut down your fat content, refined sugars, those things have to be cut down. Cut down the red meat, like you can have a white meat and also you can have the high protein like chicken and fish, but you try to cut down the red meat. And most important is the exercise. It is, with the research, it has been recommended that every day 30 minutes of aerobic exercise. Aerobic exercises means it includes running, it includes jogging, it includes cycling, this kind of swimming also. These aerobic exercises, we should be able to do it like 30 minutes every day for at least 5 days a week. So it becomes 150 minutes of aerobic regular exercises per week has been documented to show to decrease the progression also, and it helps in reversing the fatty liver also. Next, most important is to cut down smoke, stop smoking and stop alcohol intake, whoever patient is suffering from fatty liver. And always try to associate with the manage the diabetic patients, and also manage like this diabetes, hypertension and cholesterol issues should be strictly monitored, and all these patients should be screened for cardiovascular, what we call like do an ECG and echo, and check for those complications also. Next, coming to the medications, we have some medicines which are already approved, but there's a lot of research going on in this field. The next, probably in a year or two, we'll have very good molecules to treat these fatty liver patients. But as of now, we still use some of the medicines, and most importantly, we use vitamin E. Vitamin E is something which is very, very rich in antioxidants, which will help in recovering the, you know, kind of stopping that inflammation or the damage which is already going on in the liver, and also it helps to kind of revert back the liver to normal stages. And some of the diabetic medicines like pioglitazone and saroglitazole also, after doing all the blood test and the scanning, like the FibroScan and all, we assess the stages of that, and based on the stages, we kind of tailor these medicines on a patient-to-patient basis and follow up them over a period of 3 months to 6 months and repeat the values, then again check for them. And try to, we target always to have a normal liver blood test, and also to decrease, to revert back the values what we have got in the FibroScan. And some of the medicines, as I told you, there are obeticholic acid and some new medicines are there, but still they are in research, but they have not been approved as of now for day-to-day usage in the OPD. Next, most important, I told you to take care of all the comorbidities, whatever we have told. And most important, next comes down to obesity. The obesity management is the cornerstone for all these like metabolic syndromes. Obesity management always starts within self with respect to the exercise and food management always. But in case if your BMI is very high, like say more than 40 or more than 35 with all other comorbidities like sugar, BP, cholesterol and all, we do have some options for these patients to explain the, we can cut down their weight by decreasing the size of the stomach. That we can do it either endoscopically also now, or we can do it laparoscopically also. Endoscopy is a very simple normal procedure like the way we do normal endoscopies, but yeah, it will be in a procedure within, by the end, we don't be doing any incision or any scar on your abdomen. It will be completely an endoscopy procedure. We have balloons basically. We can place a balloon inside the stomach wherein like we can significantly decrease the patient's intake of food. And we can do, we can reduce the size of the stomach by doing endoscopic sleeve gastroplasty, which can also be done by laparoscopy also. But endoscopy feasibility, like it will be much better for a patient for a tolerance. So these are the 2-3 methods, like sleeve surgery, reducing the size of the stomach, or you know, placing a balloon to kind of help the patient to decrease the food intake. We can help them to cut down their weight over a period of next 3 to 6 months. And it will reflect on management of all the other conditions also. It will take care of his diabetes, it will take care of his hypertension, it will take care of his obstructive sleep apnea, and it will take care of his fatty liver also. Now, most important is, what are the safety measures this patient should take? See, once the patient develops fatty liver and he progresses to have this NASH, what we call non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, or even a chronic liver disease, always better to vaccinate these patients after testing for hepatitis B, And also for, we can give a routine vaccines, what we give for flu and all, because these patients' immunity will be on a lesser side. So it's always better to vaccinate them for influenza or even pneumococcal vaccines also. And these patients should be strictly advised, we advise them not to take any medicines without the prescription of a doctor, and after learning from them that they don't have any side effect with respect to the liver. Please try to avoid the over-the-counter medications as much as possible. And third thing is, even whatever medicine you are taking, please watch it, take a decision from your doctor, then only you take these medicines. Next, the prevention from the beginning itself, like say when the patients are already, like when they're healthy and active in the age group of 20s and 30, it is always better to, you know, start adopting a good healthy practices in terms of regular exercise, not gaining weight, and also very nutritious diet, including salads, fruits, very good protein sources like chicken and fish if they're non-vegetarian. It is always better to kind of inculcate these habits from the beginning itself, so that we don't even end up developing this fatty liver and its complications. This fatty liver diagnosis or even a prevention is very, very important, because all these patients who are in the age of 20, 30 or 40s, in the next 15 to 20 years, if they don't take care, this can progress. This can progress slowly in the background to become a chronic liver disease, which is a very, very bad thing. This can lead to very poor quality of life. It will have an economic burden. It will have a lot of social impact. So understanding all these things, I think we should be able to kind of take care of it from the beginning itself, try to prevent it from even developing. And if we have already fatty liver, so that we adopt all this lifestyle and food habit and good exercise routine daily, so that we can kind of further prevent it to progression to that worst possible things, what I was telling you, can be decompensation of liver disease, wherein ascites can be there, they can have a blood vomiting, they can have altered sensorium or agitated behavior, they're not able to concentrate on a day-to-day. They should not have this increased risk for heart attacks or stroke, because we need to take care of the other complications also, like other diseases like diabetes, cholesterol and hypertension with the same lifestyle. Basically, that will help you to, even if you're already on these medicines, these routine healthy things will help you to decrease the doses, or even you can kind of discuss with your physician to kind of decrease it, or even sometimes we are able to even stop the medicines with a very good healthy lifestyle. And also we can prevent them from progression to other non-hepatic issues like polyps in the colon or this one. So with this, I'll conclude my talk about the nature of whatever the fatty liver disease, what is fatty liver, then how does it present, what are the tests we can do, then how to manage this mostly with the, you know, without medicines. With medicines, anyway, there are options, whenever it's required, we give it. And always, what are the preventive and safety measures we take it? That is more important, if you ask me. Thank you. Now, looking at some of the questions from the audience. Okay. Ayush has asked, he is a non-alcoholic and his SGPT level is always 55 from 3 to 4 years, but says that nothing to worry. Ayush, once the value of SGPT is 55, it is usually the maximum range of SGPT value is like 39 in males, like less than 40. Once it is 55 means, it is in the second stage, what we call as a non-alcoholic steatohepatitis to hepatitis. So there is some damage has happening in the liver because of the excess fat. But it is always better for you to kind of get the viral markers, that is this hepatitis B and hepatitis C test, and also get a fibroscan done. FibroScan will exactly give you information about how much is the fat accumulation in the liver and how much the liver has become stiff over a period of time. Based on that, you can, if really required, you will be started on a medicine by whichever the gastroenterologist you can see, or else you can adopt a healthy lifestyle measures, whatever I have discussed with you, and you can relook these values after the duration of 3 or 6 months, so that it will help you to kind of achieve. But your target should be always, this LFT should become normal. And the FibroScan values, whatever you are going to get it, after that we can tell you what are the target levels you should be able to achieve. Thank you for giving this opportunity to share this knowledge about very common and very much rising in incidence, this fatty liver in a general public. I'll be happy to take back any questions. If anything, either you can post on our Facebook webpage. Thank you. Thank you, Ananda.